Well, students, in the previous lecture, we had talked about population inversion, which is a state wherein there are more atoms in the upper level than in the lower level. Okay, that is N2 greater than N1. We had also seen why for laser, this population inversion is absolutely necessary. Okay, without achieving a state of population inversion, laser cannot occur. Okay, now, this state of population inversion is something which is not going to happen on its own. Because by nature, atoms want to remain in the lower level even. So, if you leave a material on its own without you doing anything, there will always be more atoms in the lower level than in the upper level. Now, to achieve this state, that is for light amplification to occur, we must achieve population inversion. And to achieve population inversion, we have to supply energy, a huge amount of energy to the system so that we take a huge number of atoms from the lower level E1 and put them into the upper level E2 so that we achieve this state of population inversion N2 greater than N1. Now, this process of supplying energy to the system in order to achieve and maintain this state of population inversion is called as pumping. Okay, so pumping is a process of continuously supplying energy to the system in order to achieve and maintain population inversion. Now, pumping can be done by different methods. It can be done optically by supplying energy in the form of light, or it can be done thermally by supplying heat energy or mechanical energy or electrical energy. There are different methods of pumping, but whatever may be the pumping method, they all fall under only two categories. Pumping can be done only, they are called as pumping schemes. Only two pumping schemes are possible, whatever method you may use. The two types of pumping schemes are three level pumping scheme and four level pumping scheme. So only whatever method we may use for pumping, they always come under only these two pumping schemes, three level and four level. So today in this lecture, we are going to discuss about three level pumping scheme. Now, as the name suggests, there are three energy levels involved in the pumping process. Okay, E1 is the lowermost level. It's the ground state of the atom, ground state of the system. E2 is a metastable state. Now, remember, what is a metastable state? It is a state in which the atom can remain excited for a longer duration of time compared to a normal excited state. Metastable state is not a stable state. It is not a ground state. Atoms cannot remain here forever, but they can remain here for a longer duration of time. The third level is the level E3. It's the uppermost level in the system. It's also called as a pumping level. Okay, so this is a E3 is a normal excited state. It is not a metastable state. It is a normal excited state. It's also called as a pumping level. Now, in the beginning, before we start the process of pumping, that is before we start supplying energy to the system, the level E1 is highly populated, obviously, because it's a ground state. So most of the atoms are initially in the ground state. There may be some sporadic random atoms in the level E2 or E3, but they are negligible in number compared to the number of atoms in E1. Then, what do we do? In the process of pumping, we supply energy. Now, we are using a process of optical pumping here. We are supplying energy in the form of light, that is photons. So now, what we do in the beginning, atoms from the level E1, ground state, we initially take them to the level pumping level E3, the uppermost level E3. We cannot take atoms from the level E1 to the level E2. So upper transitions from the ground state to a metastable state are not possible optically. Okay. So that's why we first, through the process of pumping, supplying energy in the form of light, we take atoms from the ground state E1 and put them into the level E3. That's why it is called as a pumping level, because through the process of pumping, we are taking atoms from the level E1 and putting them into the level E3. Now, atoms which reach the level E3, they will not remain here for a long time, because E3 is a normal excited state. Atoms cannot remain here for long. So within no time, the atoms will come back down. But there are two options for atoms which release in the level E3. Either they will return back to the ground state through spontaneous emission, that is shown by this vertical arrow here downwards, or the atoms which release in the level E3, there's another option for them. They may land into the metastable state E2, shown by this slanting arrow here. Now, this transition from the level E3 to the metastable state E2 occurs through what is called as a non-radiative transition. A non-radiative transition is a energy level transition from a level E3 to E2, wherein the energy difference, so atom is coming from E3 to E2, so it's losing energy, But this energy which is lost in coming from E3 to E2 is not given out in the form of a photon. So that's why it's called non-radiative. There's no radiation, there's no photon, there's no light given out during this transition. So then where is the energy going then? The difference in the energy E3 minus E2 comes as heat or any other way of mechanical energy, but not as light. So the transition from E3 to E2 is called a non-radiative transition. So atoms which fall into the metastable state E2 through this non-radiative transition, they will tend to remain over here for a long time because E2 is a metastable state. So atoms can remain over here even up to 10 raised to minus 3 seconds, a long time compared to the normal excited state. So there will be an accumulation, collection of atoms in the level E2. So as time progresses, as more and more atoms are taken up, more and more atoms fall into the level E2, number of atoms in the level E2 will keep on increasing. As the number of atoms here increase, number of atoms here will decrease because the total number of atoms in the system are constant. They are fixed. So as number of atoms here increase, here number of atoms will decrease. Within a short period of time, we will be achieving a situation like this, wherein there are more atoms in the level E2 than in the ground state E1. And this is what is population inversion. So through the process of pumping, because of the accumulation of atoms in the metastable state, we have achieved this state wherein there are more atoms in the level E2 than in the level E1. So population inversion is achieved. Now, once population inversion is achieved, then laser can start through stimulated emission. Okay, laser stimulated emission takes place. But then, for the process of laser to start, we require one incident photon. We remember we start with one photon, then they become 2, then 4, then 8, 16 and so on. But we have to start with one photon. Now, laser occurs between the level E2 to E1 because population inversion is occurred between the level E2 and E1. So laser also occurs between the same two energy levels. It's always like that. Laser always occurs between the levels between which population inversion is achieved. Here population inversion is achieved between E2 and E1. So laser, to start the laser, we require a starting photon. And how much should be the energy of this starting photon? It should be E2 minus E1. Why? Because the laser transitions are occurring between E2 and E1. So the energy of this first photon must be E2 minus E1. So the question is now, where will this photon come from? The starting photon which starts the process of laser, 1, then 2, then 4, then 16. The first photon, where will it come from? Is it the same photon which we have used for pumping? Surely not. Because this pumping photon has an energy E3 minus E1. Because through the process of pumping, what we have done? We have taken level atoms from E1 to E3. So the energy of this pumping photon is E3 minus E1. The difference between two energy levels. Whereas here for the laser to start, the first photon must have an energy E2 minus E1. So where is this photon coming from? The first photon comes from spontaneous emission. Remember, E2 is a metastable state. And there are huge number of atoms now in the metastable state E2. But number of the atoms in level E2 will not remain here forever. Since E2 is metastable, after some time, surely one of more atoms will on their own come down. Not through stimulated emission, but through spontaneous emission. On their own, they will come down. Because even though E2 is metastable, it is not a stable state. Atoms here can remain for a long time, but not for infinite time. So at least one or few of these atoms from here on their own will come down. And when they come down on their own, they will give out a photon having energy E2 minus E1. That's spontaneous emission. So this first photon which starts the process of laser is not a stimulated emitted photon, but it is a spontaneously emitted photon from E2 to E1. Then this photon will force more atoms from E2 to come down to E1 through stimulated emissions. Each stimulated emission will give rise to two identical photons. They too will travel, collide with more excited state atoms in the level E2, force them to come down, make it 4, then 8, then 16 and so on. So within a short duration of time, we will have a laser. Light will be amplified, huge amount of light. Huge number of photons having the same energy, same direction, same phase will be created. That is a laser. But remember, the laser starts through this first photon is through spontaneous emission from E2 to E1. Now, three-level pumping scheme has a slight disadvantage, okay, compared to four-level, which we'll be seeing next time. So what is the disadvantage of three-level pumping scheme? Now, to achieve population inversion, we have to have more atoms in E2 than in E1. Now remember, E1 is the ground state here. Okay. Now this level here, E2, from where the laser starts, is called upper lasing level. And this level here, E1 where the laser transition ends, it is shown by the thick arrow here. This is the laser transition. Laser transition ends on E1. This level is called a lower lasing level. So the this is the upper lasing level. This is the lower lasing level. Now here the lower lasing level is the ground state. So therefore, to achieve population inversion, what is required is you through the process of pumping, you need to take at least more than half the ground state atoms and put them into the level E2. For example, let us say there were initially 100 atoms in the lower level. Before we start the process of pumping, we'll assume that all the atoms are in the lower level. So assume there are 100 atoms. All of them are in the lower level. Now, to achieve population inversion, what is population inversion? You have to have more atoms here, less atoms here. So, out of the 100 atoms, how many minimum atoms will be required to be taken up here? You'll require to take at least 51. So, that here remaining will be 49. So, this will be more than this. So, minimum at least 51 atoms have to be taken up from the ground state. So, that is more than half the ground state atoms have to be taken to the metastable state in order to achieve population inversion. And that requires a huge amount of energy. So, this is the drawback of 3-level pumping scheme. It requires very, very high pumping power. Okay, so therefore, very high pumping power is required because here, remember, E1, the lower lasing level, is the ground state, and this is the drawback of it. Since it's the ground state, to achieve population inversion, huge amount of energy will be required to take more than half the ground state atoms and put them into the metastable state E2. Okay, so we'll be seeing the 4-level pumping scheme next time, and we'll be seeing how this drawback of the 3-level pumping scheme is removed in the 4-level pumping scheme. Thank you.